What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Killmark Collectors. I'm Brandon, and today we're going to be going over 10 tips to help you guys get more Killmarks and be a Killmark a little bit less often. We're going to try to do it in under 10 minutes. So here we go. So putting 10 minutes on the clock here, let's jump right in with tip number 10, which is going to be group your mods and place your mods in your overview in a consistent manner. Now, what I mean by this is that I, for one, always like to put my prop mod up in the upper right-hand corner. That's just, it's easy for me to immediately hit with my thumb, and I always put my high slots down in the lower left or on the second page, things like that. By having a consistent way that you do this, you can allow yourself to always know exactly kind of where your mods are, and you'll start building that muscle memory so that you're not wasting time in a fight looking to make sure that you're hitting the right mod or anything like this. Now, this can be a little bit tedious, but trust me, it is worth it because sometimes you only have a second or two to make a decision on when to activate a mod, and if you have to spend that trying to find the mod, you may end up dead. Number 9 is going to be to test your mods before you engage. Now, typically what I like to do is right after I undock from station for the first time, go into your fitting guide, make sure that everything is active because every once in a while they will actually be deactivated, whether you ran out of Omega or it's just a bug. So if you need to dock back up and then make sure those are active, that's very important. Make sure that you're checking your rigs as well. Now, the other side here is that you do want to actually go in and try your mods out, especially for your cap usage, on some rats or an asteroid even or anything like that, so that you know exactly kind of how your ship is going to operate. The cap readout on the fitting screen can be very helpful for this to give you a general idea, but depending on if you're pulsing things or how much you're actually using them, it can be a little bit misleading. So just go in and test some of those before so that you know exactly what to expect and how much maybe shield you're getting back or how much cap you're going to be losing as you activate those mods. Number 8 is that you want to make sure that you understand your risk to ISK ratios. What I mean by this is that if you are looking at blinging out your ship and building this in such a way that you have a lot of blue gear, maybe take a look at that, especially if you are newer to PvP. It may sound sexy to have a bunch of C-type gear, but a lot of times the next step down is 1/10 of the cost and you're only losing 1 or 2 DPS, maybe, you know, 2 or 3% DPS in some of the larger weapons. So it may not necessarily be worth it for you until you get a few more kills under your belt and you understand how that ship is going to fly. The exception to this one is going to be rigs, where you get that back with insurance regardless. So I always do recommend, if you're going to spend money, bling out that ship first to get those expensive T3 rigs and then go and upgrade the mods one at a time. I still fly T3 rigs with a lot of just the normal faction mods because I can lose those and I don't like losing money. Number 7 is going to be, if you are going to be hunting in a system, to go ahead and, as you are warping even into an engagement, to go ahead and set a safe and then set your autopilot for that safe. What this allows you to do is that it will give you kind of a big red escape button if things start to go south, or if, for example, you're trying to hunt miners and a couple of other ships fall in, you can simply just hit that autopilot and it will immediately take you to a safe where you can log out or find your next destination or whatever you need to do. And you don't have to spend time waiting to try to find other places to bail. Number 6 is going to be not to underestimate E-Ward, and this includes not just the traditional E-Ward like tracking disruptors or guidance dampeners, but also newts. And newts are super powerful because everything runs off of cap, and especially with smaller ships, if you can newt them out, a lot of times you can either break tackle and get away, or you can just make it so that they can't use their prop mods or something like that. But with that, make sure that you understand how the optimal ranges and the differences in the way that those interact. For example, if you are using a large newt, understand that's got a 24-second cycle time. So even if you hit them once with it and it drains their cap 2/3 of the way or anything like that, they are going to recover some cap in between cycles. Number 5 is to use a scanner without actually scanning. What you can do a lot of times, especially if you're flying in a COVOP ship, is you can run that scan and then you can actually see where those signals are. If you see that they're in a belt or something like that, you may be able to go ahead and warp to that belt cloak to get an idea of what's actually there so that you're not generating an alert for those ships and potentially scaring them away. Now, this dovetails very nicely into number four, which is going to be to pay attention to local. Now, obviously, we want to look and see how many people are actually in local, but also pay attention to things like how many anomalies are up or how many belts are up. And in a lot of cases, if there is a ratting group in the same system as a mining group, if you attack the miners, the ratters will come to help, and it can be a bit of a sticky situation. By looking at this and knowing that, you know, maybe there's only 7 or 8 anomalies in a negative 0.9 system, there's probably a group out ratting. You can expect there to be reinforcements if you try to gank a miner or something like that. So just try to keep an eye on local, but also to keep an eye on what's in local that's more of an NPC perspective, because that can a lot of times give you some really important information. Number three is a little bit more mundane, and that is to confirm your settings before you actually engage. A lot of us switch between PvE and PvP, and so if you have your PvP settings in PvE, a lot of times you're going to have kind of an annoyance and you may not necessarily be the most effective because you don't start auto-orbiting or auto-attacking. But if you have your PvE settings on PvP, it can end up with you dead, maybe because you're auto-orbiting out of a bubble or you're just in general attacking in low sec or something like that because you have auto-attack on. These are things, again, that you just need to make sure that you're double checking. Also, be sure to check that when you are looking at all of your settings, that you look at the graphics. So if you are in a big fight, you want to make sure you turn those graphics to low to give your client as much chance to stay up with the fight as possible. Tip number two is going to be that we want to set our fitting and our optimal ranges as close as possible to our tackle distances or our ideal tackle distances. Now remember, when you are flying any ship that has a scram on it, you are pretty much going to have to be within 15 kilometers. That's for interceptors. Normally it's only about 13 kilometers for most ships. So make sure that you're fitting appropriately. If you're fitting a bunch of scrams, there's no reason to fit long range weapons. Or if you're going to be fitting long points, there's not really a reason to be actually using short range weapons, right? You want to be using that into your best ability, and this goes the same with like your prop mods. So if you're going to be in scram range and you know you're going to be fighting in scram range, there may not be a whole lot of point in using a micro warp drive because your enemy is most likely going to have a scram as well. And finally, the number one tip for improving your kill ratios is to build your fit with a specific target in mind. Now with my Bellicose 2 Covert Ops, I have gotten about 15.8 billion in kills just in the last 2 weeks while only losing 2 ships. Now, that's a pretty good ISK ratio on a ship that's only 500 million, but I could have not lost any ships if I had simply just not engaged with like cruisers or battleships or battlecruisers that I wasn't prepared to fight. By looking at your targets and being very selective and understanding when you should engage and when you should run, before you actually get into that moment, you'll be able to escape and live to fight another day, which, when we're talking about expensive ships, is kind of important. So it looks like we got a little bit of time here, so I'm going to give one bonus tip, and that is to practice, practice, practice. Whether you're trying to 1v1 to hull with people in your alliance, or you're just taking ships out for the sole sake of getting blown up and learning, I think it's a great thing for you to be able to really try things out, see what fits you like, which ones you don't, and ultimately just get a little bit more experience. Now, if you do want to try some of this, be sure to hop into the Killmark Collector's Discord channel. I will put in a link down below. We do have a bot in there that I've built to help do some fun statistics and tracking and rankings and things like that. It's not really getting a whole lot of use right now, but maybe we can change that. Either way, hop in there, drop me a message. I would love to set up a 1v1, give you some practice, and I could certainly use some myself. But either way, guys, I hope these 10 tips help you. I hope that we made it under 10 minutes. We'll see once I get into the edit mode. But either way, thank you guys so much. Be sure to like and subscribe if you enjoyed this video. And until next time, remember, kill marks last forever and fly safe. Have a good one.